I just saw the notes from the markdown, the book down. There's none there. So I guess I'm gonna
is it? Let me check. I have not look at it.
There's no none there. So
the
only thing is on the first slide, it says describe the structure of single layer neural network, multi-layer convolutional. Essentially like big picture of everything, and then slide one, slide two, and then meeting videos. There are videos from cohort one. It takes a while for me to look.
Slides, I guess, but yeah, it's not uploaded yet.
Yeah, that's okay. What I'm gonna do is try to come up with like a few slides. The section is quite interesting. It has relatively easy math, but the concept behind it is more interesting to me, like how it's handling. The concept is, I think the math is just a tool.
Yeah.
Another way to say it.
Like how I learned, I don't remember because I read this like a few weeks ago. So I remember that was like the math part, but then I also watched the video from cohort one and cohort two. So I think the cohort two explained it very well. And so the stats with Josh, right? Yeah. The video is like, he simplified all these things, makes it seem so easy to do that. It's so simple, but I haven't tried the lab, so most probably I will try the lab and we'll see how it goes. Because I always have trouble with the lab because I tried once, but the code did not run on R, so that's one of the problem.
Yeah, I might be able to, I'm not sure. We plan to move, so I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to prepare the Python version of it. But it's very interesting.
Should we use that and just record so it'll be three of us?
Yeah, so let's do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so let's begin then. Okay, so the chapter starts with some, we're gonna talk about deep learning. It seems to be a very new idea, but apparently it's been around since 1980s with a different name, actually. Initially, it was started as Neural Information Processing System, NeurIPS, NeurIPS, or NIPS. And the problem with that for a long time was the model that they were developing needed some training. The idea behind it was we can come up with a series of calculators or calculating machines in between. Those will be connected with each other. They get feedback or provide feedback from and to and from each other. And they would be able to process things kind of like a neurons in a human being brain or nervous system. The problem was any network, any neural network, you need to train it with enough data, enough information. And back in 1980s, they didn't have enough data. As a result, something like support vector machines were more popular because the training for them was easier given the data sets they had back there then. And for a long time, it was kind of in a hibernation mode until like in 2010s, around 2010, when they were able to provide a lot of computational power and training sets with the help of Google, of course, to the neural networks. And then it resurfaced as deep learning. And the main thing that helped the whole system, the whole process was the data sets. We have large data for the first time in the history of human beings and history of computer science. So we are able to train models with large data sets. Mainly we have two topics to cover in this chapter, CNNs and RNN. CNN is convolutional neural networks, which is specifically for image classification, and recurrent neural networks, which is specifically for time series or any kind of sequences. The packages that are used for doing performing deep learning is Keras for R and TensorFlow for TensorFlow is not a package, it's just a whole software by Google. The whole idea starts from single-layer neural network. Let me share this. Okay, so what you see here is a single-layer neural network. Essentially, we have a system that has an input layer with the p variables. Here are four listed that are gonna be fed into the function, and then the function fx will provide y for us. What we're doing here with one single layer here, the hidden layer that consists of a1 to a5 in the middle, we would be able to provide kind of a nonlinear function for f. So f would be a nonlinear function of bk hk's, which hk's are individually are functions of xj's. So if I step back a little bit, we don't know the exact correlation between f and x's. We want to find that correlation. We can create one layer in between that, and we claim that f is a linear function of a's, like these a inputs essentially. And then a's individually, each of a's is a linear function of the input layer. As a result, we have these eight beta k hk of x's. And since this is linear and summation on summation, that creates a nonlinear kind of correlation. We call these beta k hk's activations. And the main goal is to find essentially activations, or using the model, using the data set, train the model to find the best HK or activations or activation functions for us. So one of the easiest way to start doing the training or start estimating those HK functions has been for a long time sigmoid function, which is in the form of 1/1 plus exponential of negative to the power of exponential of negative x or negative z in this figure. So for a long time, the sigmoid function was kind of the go-to, the first shot, and it's been giving the scientists the best result they wanted. However, one easier step than this sigmoid function is ReLU, which is rectified linear unit. So anything below zero, the ReLU will give it zero, and then anything beyond, which is after zero, it's gonna be linear function. So g of z is gonna be zero if z is negative, it's gonna be z itself if it's otherwise. So there are three benefits to use the ReLU over the sigmoid function. One of them it's gonna be stored way easier. Second one is it's gonna create a threshold of zero at zero, and then there will be a constant term omega k zero that will shift this inflection point. So this inflection point that we have at zero can be shifted. It can be at zero, negative one, positive one, depending on the omega k zero that we have in this equation. So it's not like written in the ground, unchangeable. We can change it if we need to. Okay, so you may ask one basic question. We had classifications before, we had trees before, we had SVM before, and we had linear options before. Why are we insisting on non-linearity in this function? The main reason for that is we want to capture more complexities here. Essentially, when we turn to deep learning, the problem we had was the simpler linear functions or linear approximations didn't work, and we want to capture non-linearity. That's why we use the sigmoid function. However, sigmoid function alone can be too cumbersome and too complex. So ReLU function can give us some simple non-linearity. With a linear function inside another linear combination, it will produce a nonlinear output, yet it is simple and linear in its origin. I hope that makes sense. If not, I have this. There is this YouTube channel, 3 Blue 1 Brown. I don't know if you've seen this channel before, but the guy is very smart, and he has an incredible ability to explain very complex mathematical problems in a very simple format. If you look into his what is a neural network video, he would explain this concept way easier and way more comprehensible than what I explained. Essentially, he goes to one of the examples that we have in the book. If you look at the thumbnail from the video, you can see the 3-9 in the handwriting format. The main challenge of neural network at the beginning was we want to scan handwriting. That's the first thing that they wanted to do, and numbers are the easiest one. You have 10 combinations from 0 to 9. We want to detect whatever is written into one of those formats. I don't have a picture of figure 10.3, but if you go to the book, you can see it's written pretty much like this thumbnail. And essentially what they decided to do is to create one image, one low resolution image from every single digit. And in that reading, you have three types of pixels in those in that picture. It's either zero, it's blank, it's either fully written, it's fully like it has zero, and like now it's one, you know, it's fully written and you can try to find a pattern there, or it's something in between. So what they tried to do was come up with an idea of, okay, let's kind of with a ReLU function slash the ones that are in between, create a threshold and slash some of them. And now the outcome of that is you either have 0 or 1. And now try to see if you can detect a pattern from those pictures that you just came up with. And the whole idea in neural network is try to come up with that. The pictures that they came up with, they were very low resolution, 28 pixel by 28 pixel, meaning that you have 784 inputs, 28 by 28, 784 inputs. And each of those inputs had the variations between 0 and 1. Now you have two hidden layers in that model. Essentially, they created two hidden layers, layer 1 and layer 2, out of the 784 layers. The first layer, they said it's going to be 256 units. Essentially, they said it's going to be between zeros and ones and for the pixels and the intensity of the pixels. And then the second layer, they tried to reduce the first layer by half, and it had 128 layers. And then they tried to come up with the output, the 10 numbers for the output layers. So out of 780 something, they reduced it in 2 layers to 10. Not this picture. So the combinations of the first two layers can be 200,000 for this, for the input layer and the hidden layer. So 200,000 combinations or options go to the hidden layer with L2, which is 128, and now it goes to 10 layers, which will tell us if it's 0, 1, or any number up to 10. So what they did, they tried different neural network methods with different regularizations for the steps in between. So for W1 and W2, they used some filters. They tried to come up with some, how should I put it? Some ways of essentially trying to detect the patterns. And they had different error rates. Essentially, what you want to compare with is the linear discriminant analysis that we had at the very beginning of the book, this book. It created 12% error using the linear functions, the linear combinations. Then the more complex version, which was multinomial logistic regression, it created 7% error. And then when they used the neural network, dropped under 3%, depending on the type of regularization they used. Okay. So the rest of it is, the rest of this section is more math and how to handle it. And it's explaining how the neural network can be applied to other databases and introducing other databases. MNIST, which is the handwritten database for the numbers, handwritten digit problem, essentially, database is about the numbers. There are a lot of numbers written by different people and they are reduced to those 28 by 28 pixel pictures, and you can use them to train your neural network, whatever neural network you come up with. There is another database, it's called CIFAR 100, which is a collection of pictures of nature, and what they want to do is to classify those pictures into 100 different species or 100 different animals. So what they do is essentially, they do the same thing. They show the picture to the network. The network or the algorithm they come up with, it tries to detect patterns like these patterns that you see here. And then it tries to put the patterns together and detect eyes, nose, mouth, any features of the face or features of the body, and then assign those features to the name of the animals. So that's the concept that they are trying to do, or using the CIFAR 100 database. So now, very subtly, I introduced the concept of convolutional neural networks to you. Essentially, it's CNN is used for classification of images. What it does, it tries to detect patterns inside the picture, and then using the pixels and the pixel intensity, it tries to detect the patterns, put the patterns together to detect features of the body or face or whatever it's trying to detect. And then the outcome of those features will tell or will decide, will help to the algorithm to decide whether it's an animal, it's a waterfall, it's an insect or anything like that. CNN essentially is trying to mimic how human is classifying the images. If you do photography, once in a while you see, like, when this camera is trying to detect faces, it puts faces on the picture, so you know it detected the face and it tries to zoom in and focus on the faces. That's pretty much what it does. It's trying to do a face detection in real time using these features and trying to match the features with a face, essentially. So to do that, each of these layers that helps us to detect the features, they are called convolution filters or convolution layers. They are essentially templates that determine whether a particular local feature is present or not. And what happens is we have an original image in the simple format. Imagine we have a 4x3 image. We have this original image. And then we use convolutional filters, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, on this image. The outcome is instead of 4x3, it's now 2x3. So it reduced the image size into this convolved image. And then you have these linear combinations. So the outcome of these, it's going to be a number, right? Each of these elements for this convolved image matrix is going to be a number. So it can help us to magnify a feature of the original image or not. So if we apply this to something like a tiger face and apply a vertical filter versus horizontal filter, this is the image that we get. So the top image emphasizes on the patterns on the tiger face, which are vertical. Notice the lines on the right and left side of the tiger's face. They are pretty much similar to the actual image. While on the bottom picture, which had the horizontal filter on it, those lines are blurred. However, the forehead of the tiger that has horizontal lines, they are now emphasized as compared to the original picture, like the top picture that is not emphasized or less emphasized. So using this filter, the filter can be as simple as a 3x3. The top row could be 0, the bottom row could be 0, the middle row could be 1. And that's it. That emphasizes, that amplifies the the lines. So that's how the filters are working. Essentially, by these filters, you can create filters to detect, to emphasize eye features, like they emphasize round objects on the picture, right? You can create a filter to magnify the nose, which is a kind of L, whatever you want to imagine. So they operate on localized patch of the input of the image, and then the same weight is given to the filter and can be reused for all possible patches of the image. And then each patch that is amplified, you can consider it as, oh, there is a pattern there. You can go back there and then apply other filters, or combine this specific filter with another filter that, for example, helps you to detect the eye. So as a result of that, if you apply it to something like this, so the image, this is another example in the book. So if you apply the filter there, the filter, which here it just tries to isolate one portion, one patch of the picture, tries to find the maximum, and then takes that maximum in. And then for the top left corner, 3 is the maximum. So the top left corner element is 3, and so on and so forth. Here you can see, okay, the top right corner has more like significance for that specific filter. That filter is just max pool. So instead of doing calculations using alpha, beta, gamma, and delta, it tries to maximizes those patches. So that's how you pull the layers together and condense a large image into smaller image. Essentially, this is somewhat representative of the original image. So you may wonder why. So in the previous picture here, I showed a colorful tiger. It's colored, it's RGB, and the outcome is black and white. You may wonder what happened to the color. So essentially, that's the architecture of a convolutional neural network, CNN. Essentially, what you do is you split it into the building blocks, red, green, and blue. And then for each of those, you have to do the convolution. You increase the three images, 32 by 32, to 32 layers. And then you pull them together using the max pool or whatever filter that you want. Then you reduce it. Then you convolve it again. You have more layers. You pull it together. Now the depth from 32 bits, decrease to 16, decrease to 8. Now convolve again. Then pull again. You decrease it to 4. 4 goes to, you flatten it to 500, and then you do another pooling or another filter that helps to reduce it to 100. Now that 100 can be converted, can be translated to what is that animal, or what is that feature, what is that creature that you have in the picture. I've been going so fast. Is there any question? Was it clear so far? Okay, great.
It's good for me. Jeremy, do you have
a question?
No, okay.
Okay, great, awesome. So you can, one thing that you could also do using this layering, essentially, this, you can distort the image, change, twist it, shift it, in different ways, and that those create new data for you to train on. Essentially, from one image, you can have multiple combinations because you are trying to detect patterns, and patterns should stay the same of the same picture. Even if you distort it, like stretch it, if you turn it, if you compress it in one direction and not another direction. So that can be also performed to kind of, it's called the data augmentation. So to create more data for your training data set. There is no limit. As long as you can create new image, somewhat new images, that can be repeated and can be continued again and again and again. There is one benefit to this data augmentation, and that protects against overfitting. So there is another data set which is called ResNet 50. That data set is industry level pre-trained classifier to predict the class of some new images. Essentially, that helps you. It has different pictures with higher resolution, different features in them, and you can detect animals in those. So when they use the algorithm that they had for on these images, essentially they introduced flamingo and they received probability for different animals. They didn't see one name, one word for the outcome. It was a probability for multiple words. For flamingo, you can see it for 17%, it detected that it's spoonbill. I don't know what that is. For the Cooper hawk, there was 60% that it, from the point of view of the network, 60% that it's a kite. But when they zoomed out, it forgot that there was a bird in between, and it detected the fountain way better. Still low probability. So much of the work in fitting the CNN is essentially in learning the convolution filters at the end, at the hidden layers. So it's important to work on those to figure out what is the best set of multipliers for those hidden layers in between. You can use those pre-trained data sets and hidden layers for new problems. And that would be called, let me read from the book again. One can use the pre-trained hidden layers for new problems with much smaller training set, a process referred to as weight freezing. So essentially you're going to use something like ResNet's pre-trained data set multipliers and then introduce your own data set or introduce it to your own environment and then benefit from some pre-work, some work that was done on the model before. So you don't start from scratch. So that's about the image classification. There is another world of document classification that goes to section 10.4. And essentially it has started from the world of essentially business, starting when they wanted to classify the reviews. And nowadays we are very, very familiar with the reviews as a human being. We can go in, read them, and we can understand from the text and the stars whether the guy was angry and leaving just an irrational comment, or they were really unsatisfied with the product, their review was fair, and the product was not good. So this is called sentiment analysis, and they started from this. They started the work from IMDb ratings, the comments from there, and they were trying to see if they can train a model. And the model would go in, read the comments and reviews, and then based off of those, come up with whether it would worth watch this video, this film or not. There are multiple ways to do the analysis. One of them, the simplest and most common format, is bag of words. Essentially, it would try to drop the most common words and it would try to read the words that are not common and put a weight to them and see if they are good or not. I didn't take a picture of that, but if you have the book in front of you, section 10.4, there are two green sections that has like a negative review. And then the next green section is applying the bag of word model to this. Essentially, they try to featureize that review into something smaller. So what they did, they applied different neural networks using Lasso and two hidden layer neural network to that database. And what you see is the black dots are showing the trained model. The turquoise one is showing the validation set and the orange one is showing the test set. In two different way of weighing the accuracy, one of them using negative log of lambda for the lasso, and the other one shows as epoch, which is the number of times fitting algorithm passes through the training set. As you can see, the training set has a good agreement, good level of accuracy up to a certain point, but as the epoch, the number of times fitting the algorithm increases, essentially after a certain point, which is very low, it loses its accuracy. I mean, depends on what is your criteria. Sometimes 80% is good enough, and if 80% is good enough, and you have a good model. But if your model needs to pass 90% accuracy, in both cases, it fails. So what they tried to do was using the bag of word model, they assigned 0 and 1s to the words. And then that's how they converted the paragraph or the text into a matrix. So it was understandable by the machine. So they created the binary vectors of length of 10,000, mostly consisted of zeros. So they converted the paragraphs to that. and then the result, they had a training test set and a test set, each one of them with 25,000 examples, and each of them were balanced with regards to the sentiment, and they their result matrix was 250 million element matrix. But the matrix is so large, however, only 1.3% of the binary entries are non-zero. So although the text is so large, most of it had converted to zero. For example, if you go to the example that was written in the comment, this, the word this can be weighted as zero. However, the word, I'm trying to find it, bad can have a weight of one, right? So most of the words, you can imagine, most of the words are just building the sentences, and one or two or three words are delivering the sentiment or the meaning or the emotions. Those three words can be weighted one, the rest of them can be weighted zero, and zero doesn't mean anything for the computer, right? So it's easy to handle that large data set. So that's how they did the essentially analysis for the using the bag of word method. With that, essentially, that was the CNN model. The next step is the recurrent neural networks, and how it works is essentially, instead of one big giant layer or multiple layers, what they do, they introduce each element to one machine, and then they get one output, then they feed it to the another one, the income from the first layer, the first classification parameter to the next one. And that goes on and on, and essentially it's it creates this first picture. You have the X input that goes to the classifier, and then the classifiers are feeding each other, and then it goes to the output. If I go back to the first image, the first image we had was the inputs were going to the hidden layer, going to the output. It was completely feeding forward. Now here, the classifiers in between are feeding each other, and they provide feedback to each other. That can, depending on the work that we want to do, can help or not the process. So I have a suggestion, stop here and then continue next week.
Yeah, sure. If you want, yeah, we don't have to use up all the time. We can end early.
No. I thought this could be a good distinction. Today we work on CNN. Then next week we're gonna go work on the RNNs. They can be a little bit separate, distinct from each other. So it would be easier to shift.
Can you go back to that? Was like one graph, the figure 10.11. That's the accuracy.
11. Yeah. Okay.
So can you explain I was confused about the epoch. So this is the training. The black lines are the training one, right?
Yes.
Then the blue is the validation.
I was confused about it too. So let me find my notes.
I'm confused about this figure. They say that both shows a tendency to overfit, but it seems that their accuracy is about the same, whether we are on the neural network or on the lasso treatment.
Okay, so the first one, so to explain the picture, the lasso is indexed by the regularization parameter lambda. The neural network, the right-hand one, is indexed by the number of gradient descent iterations used in the fitting, as measured by the training epochs or passed through the training set. The training accuracy for increases by increases monotonically, obviously, as you increase the number of the exposure of the model to the samples, the training accuracy increases. And it says, I'm trying to see how I justified it for myself, how I explained it to myself. And so it says in the figure we show accuracy fraction correct rather than classification error, which is fraction incorrect, which is more popular in the machine learning community. Both models achieve a test set accuracy about 88%. And the difference in the errors is essentially coming from the way they are calculating the accuracy. No, I was wrong. I take back the last sentence.
So it just seems like for the lasso regularization,
mm-hmm.
It seems that for the train and the test data set, right?
Yes.
And even for the neuro, the one on the right panel, their performance.
I didn't understand. Can you repeat?
Yeah. It means that because they mentioned it specifically, like you mentioned, because this one I was looking at accuracy, it seems that both have the same accuracy. That's what it feels mm-hmm. like. So it means that sometimes we don't really necessarily need to use neural network if we able lasso is like performing quite similarly well. But then I was just curious, like, because they didn't mention that under what condition they will perform similarly well, like in what conditions mm-hmm. like neural network would be like better. But I also remember they talked something about cross validations. It's like where you run multiple models, then you use a cross validation mm-hmm. to determine which is a better model, which one would like highly to predict things better, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's possible that they adjusted the parameters of lasso. The one thing that is mm-hmm. interesting is the speed at which it reached the accuracy. So mm-hmm. of course, when we move from left to right, it shows like how much the model was exposed to training to reach that accuracy. The neural networks achieve the accuracy within like accuracy of 90% within 2 or 3 tries, right? Apparently.
Yeah.
But for lasso, it took a while to get around 90%.
Still, needs to go up.
Yeah, still both of them, when they were validated or tested, they showed similar performance between validation and test, which is very reasonable. And it's very curious to see, although they are very different, I'm not sure how much computationally they are different, like how much time difference would it take to run two different methods. But they are showing similar results.
Isn't it take longer time to run the neural network one?
That's what I'm wondering. So a while ago I was trying to learn machine learning, and I was working with lasso, One time I made a mistake. I gave it, so the instructor said something to set the number for the cross validation to test these four items. Instead of four, I was curious and tested 10. And that regression take like about 10 minutes. I'm not sure if like neural network would take the same amount of time or not for this specific data set, but all I'm trying to say is it's very curious to see how they are performing on the same data set with very similar parameters. They are not exactly the same, but similar parameters. Because again, as I said, I was able to mess up lasso, so it took 10 minutes, which was supposed to take 2 seconds. So.
Oh, I think we can stop it. Jeremy, do you have other questions?
No. I think my internet connection is going to be really unstable here.
Yeah, no, it's fine. So if there's no questions, then let's just stop here. Then we will continue and meet. We'll see you guys all next week around the same time.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. See you
for the presentation. Bye. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you.